Come on! I'm gonna start singing if I don't see butts and seats soon. Actually, the lights are so bright I can't see much at all, but I see these are empty. These are really good seats. If I was to like crowd surf, that would be the perfect place to sit. You catch me? Thank you. Okay. Hi, my name is Michelle Steinwald. That was just a little diversion to get some more people sitting. And welcome. Today's performances are part of the National Performance Network and Visual Artists Network annual meeting. And it is hosted by our local partners, Women in Their Work and Fusebox. Thank you so much. Get in the light. Everybody get in the light. Okay. Nobody left behind in the spotlight. I'm just making sure I'm still in the spotlight too. What? Okay. Okay, the last part I need to tell you is that the performances you're seeing, the local artists have been selected by the local host committee, and that the national artists were all part of the NPN Creation Fund and Fourth Fund projects, and those artists were chosen by NPN staff, board, and artists. Thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm production coordinator for Live and On Stage. So, in alignment with NPN Band's commitment to creating an arts sector rooted in justice, we are committed to ensuring a space that is free of racism, transphobia, homophobia, ableism, misogyny, classism, or other bias. The Creation Fund and Fourth Fund work is supported by Doris Duke Charitable Foundation, Ford Foundation, National Endowment for the Arts, Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, and co-commissioning organizations. Local support was provided by the City of Austin Economic Development Cultural Arts Division, the Austin Convention of Visitors Bureau, and Texas Commission on the Arts. And performances tonight are being live streamed by HowlRound TV.
Hey everyone, I'm Ron with Fusebox. Wonderful to have you here. I'm less advanced than Michelle. I'm reading the hell out of this thing. So we'd like to thank our production teams, the state side here at the Paramount. They've been amazing hosts and partners. Thank you. Ben Levine, our fabulous production manager. Superstar. Sadie Legenkamp, our stage manager. Thank you. Orchid Robinson. A few reminders, there is an intermission, so that's cool. There's a late night live art extravaganza happening tonight. It's being hosted by Women in Their Work, Chris Cowden, and Fusebox. It's tonight from 9 to 11 at the Museum of Human Achievement, which is an amazing space. It's featuring performances from 5 local artists. I would also ask you to turn off your cell phones, which is actually, this should be just a very pleasurable thing for all of us. To turn those things off, it's a great meditative opportunity. And I also want to tell you that the hospitality suite is open in room 1102. And I think that's all I have.
All right, give it up for them, y'all. Good afternoon to my fellow NPN family. On behalf of our board of directors, thank you all. I'm Javon Collins, I'm from Columbus, Ohio, and I serve on the board from the King Arts Complex. So you may know me, you may not. That's who I am. That's me. So I'm here to announce about the raffle. How many of you all got your raffle tickets? All right. Do you all know what the raffle prize is? I'm going to tell you, does anyone like the city of New Orleans, Louisiana? All right, well, the grand prize is a weekend in New Orleans, airfare, lodging, in the Margini, and Jazz Fest tickets included, y'all. So you got to jump on that. So the tickets will be available during intermission and after the show. The drawing will be held at the party tomorrow evening. So you do not have to be there to be a winner. So get plenty of tickets. You can be at home, check your texts, you're going to New Orleans, all right? So I want to thank you all. Have a great time with the show. Thank you, NPN. Thank you, Austin. Let's get it. Thank you, NPN. Thank you, NPN.
If your child needs a role model and you ain't it, you're both fucked. George Carlin, comedian. This is where we begin. That moment, first moment, when you, new daddy, are holding your child for the first time and you are frightened. Not of the moment, but of what you're looking at. Because newborn children are anything but beautiful. In fact, newborn children look like the drawings of a deranged, psychopathic six-year-old. The giant head, that oblong giant head, those really big giant eyes, the hands turned into little mallets, and that alienotic language they're speaking, which translate probably means human. You will die soon, but don't worry, give it an hour, some take a day, maybe a week, and they will morph into looking like one or both their parents. It's what they do. They're aliens. So there will come a moment during that day when you will be alone with your child, and the alien will do something to bring you into their web. Some will coo, others will just stare at you with those giant eyes. For me, both of my children, they smile at the sound of my voice. And in that moment, you have to make a decision. You have to decide what you are going to give this child. Are you going to pass on your fears, your prejudices, your bullshit, your doubts? Or are you going to help this child to shape and see the world through their own lens, make their own decisions? And when that is what you decide that you're going to do, but you just became a daddy. Because any male with working sperm can be a father. But daddies, daddies, they do. And when you become a daddy, that's when you're fucked!
I want to
become
my daddy as soon as possible.
Yeah.
I want to become my daddy as funny, silly, loving, and caring. The best gift that my dad has ever gave me was love. My dad's a good dad because he gives me love and affection and he cares for me.
She like a jazz drama solo, in sync with the universal order, spins with elegance and graceful and fast. She laughs with her head back, mouth open like a Charlie Brown comic strip. My baby girl shines and she speaks with the syncopated staccato of an 88 key jazzologist. Eyes always on me. And when she don't get she way, she sandstorms the pyramids with her black girl magic, with her fist clench and foot stomp. When a door slam, my voice raised, her chin becomes attached to her chest, but we talk it out, teachable moment, and we hug. And she hugs too tight sometimes, like an anaconda where I can't breathe or I can't take a step because she's wrapped herself around my leg. And in the car, we are plug tuning with beat, daylight, soul sound, sunny weather, whether inclement weather approaches, she is grinning with full face and body. See me cleaning? She wanna assist in every area, but she will. She is boot in bathroom, boot in living room, but never she closet. She's a never-ending cycle of joy, fashion conscious, would change clothes 5 times in a day if I let her. She like a jazz drummer solo, in sync with the universal order. She is the intricate pattern and the rhythm rhyme roller. She is literally like a jazz drummer. Boom, 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 boom. That's her energy, and not even sun can match it. And she be me, mine, morning glory, funny face focus, genius, bouncing bunny, burning bright. And me, well, I be dada, and I am loving her way past my extended lifetime wart. So as a new parent, there are things that you expect, anticipate, and accept. You expect the bodily fluids, man. Oh my God. And as a germaphobe, just the idea of having to wipe someone else's dirty, stank ass can be quite traumatic. As a germaphobe, you don't want to clean your own ass. I do. Calm down. And as a germaphobe, going into theater is probably not the best career path to take. Because, you know, theater people, they're communal, they build sets and sweat, touch each other, eat each other's food, drink at each other, sit around in the dressing room butt-ass naked, and where you're supposed to sit. I digress. And I know that my little evil alien babies would wait till it was my time to change them when they would have those, them Jackson Pollock type of shits, man. The red, blue, green, splattered everywhere, down their thigh, up their back. See, this is further proof we know there are aliens. Your asshole is pointed down. How you got shit on your back? They're kids. So you anticipate that they're gonna make messes, they're gonna break things, they're gonna throw fits and tantrums, they're gonna see if your cell phone will float in the toilet twice, they're going to deplete your bank account, rob you of your dreams, and destroy your body, right? What you don't expect is to wake at 3 o'clock in the morning to the blinking eyes of your toddler. Now you're sitting straight up in bed at 3 o'clock in the morning, your toddler's standing there, you got questions. And that toddler won't say anything once you wake up, they just waddle their ass right out of the room. But you got questions like, were you watching me while I was sleeping? And what else have you been doing while I was sleeping? See, this is just my theory, right? Now you can roll with it if you want to, but this is what I think happens. I think that while we're sleeping, they sneak into our room with a long liquid alien metallic tube. They shove this inside our ear canal. Our mouth comes out of their stomach, out of their human mouth. It begins to suck. What are they doing? They're taking our memory and our energy. Tell me what parent don't have memory and energy issues. They take our memory and our energy, they send it out to whatever little alien plant they're from. Them aliens take our memory and energy, spray it on hexagon crackers, and they eat it while they're drinking mint tea. It's just... That's just my theory. That's what I think. Cause they're fucking aliens!
I just kind of have funny understanding, easily angered, aggravating, a little germophobic. A little screechy, and go up. He's a good dad. He's an okay dad. He can understand the problem because he's a teacher, and he teaches that he teaches kids that my age, so he can understand that when we have problems, and he can understand how to solve it.
My son has. My son has. My son has autism. And it has changed over the years on how they want you to say that. First, it was a mild form of autism. Then it was a slight case of Asperger's. Now it's he registers on the autistic spectrum. It's a mouthful, I know. He's fully functional, has problems sometimes making eye contact or meeting strangers, and forgets things, but I don't know if that's the autism or 17-year-old male not fully developed frontal lobe. but he's gonna have hurdles. It's not enough that he is born black and male in a country that has placed very little value on a black male's life. So little value that in Florida, while a black male walked home with Skittles and tea, he was followed by a neighborhood officiant idiot after being told by police not to follow him, murders him, goes to court, doesn't go to jail. Or in Cleveland, Ohio, where a 12-year-old black male was playing with a toy gun in a park, the first responding officer, it took him 2.5 seconds to draw his weapon and fire. That same officer was a first responder, but refused to provide medical attention to that 12-year-old or call for medical backup. So that 12-year-old died. So it's not enough that you were born black and male in a country, now Trump's America, but you have autism, which is defined as a developmental disorder that inhibits the way you communicate, and it took me, your father, years to be able to say that sentence. My son has. It's like, if I just never said it, it wouldn't be true. Or if I just ignored your ticks, your pacing back and forth, your needing to touch things in the set of palms of your hands, sometimes you go away and I wonder what wonderful world are you playing in, son? Or how your tongue sometimes doesn't wrap around the words so that you can articulate them, but I can give you acting exercises to help that. Or when you stumble with reading, I would be there to catch you. Or when you need to touch things in the center palm of your hands, son, my son has. Like it's gotta be somebody's fault, right? Did me and your mother not provide you the proper nutrition while she carried you? Did I play too much Coltrane, not enough Mozart while you were in the womb? Did I not talk to you enough while you were in the womb? Did I not hold you enough? My son has. And one day, you were six, just you and I in a store. You're spinning about, touching things in the center palm of your hands, and I just reached out and touched your shoulder. You turned around, looking like your mother, smiling like me, and I simply held you. And I whispered in your ear, you are my son. And I love every puzzle piece that connects you, even the ones that are missing. You are perfection personified. I am proud to be your father. My son has autism. My son. My son. My son.
large. I mean, just the text is really out of place. The three of us that were going to each other, and then one joined the player, and until the very end. So that was hard. But it was kind of
according to my own moral code, I give myself an A minus. Okay, fuck it, B plus. 8, 9 out of 10 times, I'm probably doing the right thing. I think the law inherently acknowledges that you can't enforce every rule all the time. That eventually, the consistently misbehaved will be caught. And then there's an allowance for most of us, almost kind of good people. There's no allowance for us, almost kind of good people, to be in the right. And I have been in the right, on the right-hand side of the road, so many times, for the wrong reasons. The first time, a police officer told me that I had driven through the parking lot of a movie theater too many times. The second time, I made it inside the movie theater, but the best fight scene actually happened before the movie even started. It was two Chinese families who literally fought themselves out of the building, left all the brothers just sitting there and quote, "Boo!" It wasn't us. Third time, cop car followed my Toyota Solara through the streets for about 10 minutes, pulled me over, checked my license, and when I checked out, he said he couldn't see whether I changed my tag or not. Those tags are color-coded for that particular reason. So you can see. You can't see? I don't think you should be walking around with a gun, player. You can't see. Are you colorblind? Clearly not. The fourth time, I'm walking across the street and a park cop car flashes the top beams at me. It's awkward. So I'm inclined to wave high. At least I keep walking and the car just speeds towards me and then just drives off. Like it was a bluff. Like I would run first and wonder what I was guilty for later. I'm not. The fifth time. I'm not a bad person. I go to college here. I anything like this wrong. I don't know what he's feeling. Please, come on, let it fly. Let it fly. He says it's too late. Mug shots. Fingerprints. Everything is processed. I might miss my show when you do it. I can't call my parents. I will call my parents. That's $10,000 for paper. I can't call cell phones from here. I don't know anybody with a landline except my parents. I can't call my parents. I can't call my parents. They don't need this. How do I get myself out of this? No one knows I'm here. No one knows I'm here. I take off my clothes. I bend over. I put on a jumpsuit. I'm in jail.
Can I get myself out of this?
No one knows I'm here.
Who's on me here?
Where's my man?
These are my cellmates.
These are my cellmates. I'm in jail. It's like the lover who took you back after you cheated and then bringing it up every night. What's the fucking point? Until I die, I'll always be. I mean, there are no adjectives in the English language that can make the word felon any better. You want to try? All right. You old creative writing workshop teaching felon. Toni Morrison reading, middle class, Elton John listening in, spelling, college graduating, decent credit rating having, backpack rapping, square ass glasses wearing, poetry playwright, young black male fella. Sounds like an insult. Hi. My name is. Good nigga. You know, if we're gonna use labels. I'm a good nigga. Like, I recycle and shit. I'm a good nigga. This is what I managed to gather from the random white people who might have thought of it a compliment to say, I like black people like you. Or, you're one of the good ones! Which my Rosetta Stone for racism translated to, you're a good nigga. I didn't mind it. I actually kind of liked it. It kind of made me proud. Being a good one was kind of like being a nigga. Black folks could say it to me endearingly. White people probably shouldn't say it out loud. If I was trying to prove anything to anyone, it was to my crew, to my peers, that I could be down without letting the man hold me here. Now, I always got this feeling like I was born with the stripe already, that through goodness, I could receive penitence, forgiveness for a sin not my own. And yeah, I am good, and bright, and qualified, and polite. I'm not on violent. I got a pretty good outlook on life. I smile a lot. My teeth are bright. They think that I'm cute. My nose is right. My lips just big enough. My dick just big enough. Fuck! You like? What it do? Are you in the mood for a little bit of taboo? I do like check off, and I know you like to check off your to-do. I am the desire without the fear. I'm trustworthy, I'm safe, you need diversity in the workplace, great, I need a career, I'm just playing the game with the tokens given, I mean we already really want the chocolate factory, here's your golden ticket, your fixation, your methadone prescription, Starbucks equivalent to your fantasy addiction, your pleasure, your diet soda, your fat-free loaf, your coke free crack, your Barack Obama, your Vodafone, why you didn't even know it was black? We the elephant in surprise, the black white elephant in the room, the beauty of the pain, the fellowship of the soul. I'm not talking to the television, the television, the soul. You're so sweet, Bob, but you're talented too. I'm the talented tickle, the tickle, the level of the seven, from you, from you, from you, from you. When it goes so I got a million good excuses for why I'm here. Excuses that I like. They sound smart. Like this white dude, Steve.
You think I go to Starbucks and shoot espressos every morning because I want to? Fuck no, man. I'm making a statement. Enough of anything will kill you. So I can't have a little bit of growth because I'll die? Watch me on the nose on white mocha's, you fucks. I'm shutting Starbucks down. First heart attack, I'm a millionaire. People are so fucking stupid. Get all the uncomfortable slogans. Lady, this isn't a truck. Bullshit, bullshit. I done truck. I'm dying, man. I know the truck. I'm fucked up right now.
You don't listen to all the logically flawed, racially problematic,
half-baked shit that he'd be saying half the time, most of it, 75, a lot. I kind of hear him, you know. I want to believe even more than he that me being here is mass plot, government conspiracy. Okay, it's only probation. And it's only a lie that I'm addicted and afflicted and sick and in need of help. But in my mind, there's no denying that all this talk of bottom is beneath me. Like, really, this is beneath me. Like, my whole family is like, are you a drug addict? Like, my brothers, they're like, you're a drug addict. I'm like, shut up, only two more drugs than me. Death Mary, the Virgin, like me, I mean, not to the group, I mean to the group, not sexually, first offense, some are regulars, like my man Samples over here. They call him Samples because he keeps a souvenir of every place he's been to, woman he's been through, everything he's tried, carried with him through jewelry or tattoo. He's a collector of the past. Lost one eye, but you'd swear it was a good bargain. Like he ain't missing. You taking offense to me saying nigga? Well, you right. I'm kind of offended that you offended. I was just caught with four stems of magic mushrooms. A quantity worthy of a felony in two states. California and I think Alabama. My state solution was for me to find a god of my own understanding. That's what I was trying to do with the mushrooms. They say I'm tripping. I'm not drug abstinent, but I'm not a drug addict. And I am not in denial, but that's what every drug addict in denial says. So I say nothing. There is no gray area. Like the way the law is supposed to be. There's no gray area like the way this old black man in the program we call Pastor, he talks about everything. Just black and white. And I hope that it's black and white between us. Because he's like this old black cliche. I just never wanted to be. Which means I'm a bad fit for systems. for the religious, for falling in love, asleep, or for anything. I just can't help but look down. They share words and similar ideas of witness and testimony and confession and judgment. And when the judge tells me, well, son, if you get caught with drugs and you don't have a drug problem, well then, frankly, it's just a problem. He insists that I admit drug addiction in order to avoid admittance into prison. And I shit you not, I have a religious experience. I mean, all of a sudden, I'm 14 again, and my bowed head is held by this sister from Calvary Christian. She's a missionary, and her mission is to get me, along with 50 other teens, to speak in tongues once the Spirit jumps into us. Like this. Sorry, number five. I'm a monarchia. Coming now, beyond Beyonce. And then we're saying, pray for me, party in English, party in Rihanna, Beyonce, and that's why I can't translate, so I can't tell if she's doing it right, but I just know it's not changing, but she says she ain't stopping until I join with the company. It's for the sake of my salvation, it's either this or hell, and I was introduced to religion through Catholicism, so trust me, I know all about guilt. It frightens me beyond belief that I might be beyond Satan. Or that this all might be bullshit. So I hope.
Hey! Why not die? Tippity!
Fuck no. I was 14. Pooty Tang just came. I was confronted by the jail of hell. And just like now, all I gotta say is what these saviors seek, as if my soul is more for sale than for sale. Where else the two rituals still exist besides the church and the court, where everything is forever? And it feels like it's the same world. I mean, even I'm the same, I'm still willing to lie before forever to save me some time and some pressure. I believe a few things are forever. A lie before God, and now this thought to be forged on my felonious record. I'm fucked for life and for afterlife. For I have lied before God, I have swore false before religion, I lied. In these places I'm supposed to be honest, I lied and fell inside myself. Where I stay, convince these systems, these places, they just ain't for me. God has lost the faith. This is a little racket. A little bathroom deal where we really deal with nothing. When they buy benevolence with false mercy, and I sell my word until it ain't worth shit. These drug courts were legislated with a particular face in mind. A Reagan-era design that deemed drug use and drug abuse and drug addiction and crackhead and black people synonymous. I am drug addict anonymous. No one cares what my problem is. I'm a problem in this system. I don't have a drug problem. You don't care about fixing me. You just looking for a fix. For the first time, not violent, drug offender. I feel like I'm one of many being pushed out of the finish line. It's the way it felt. It's one side, it's all the other side. What's going to happen?
tank reference. Yeah.
Oh my God.
How's it going? So David carefully explained to me that Ben carefully explained to him that if I talk too much and we go over, he'll shut off the lights. So this was the problem in Marfa when we did this, the first piece, and I talked, Sean explained afterwards, I talked for longer than the music lasted, so I'm gonna be careful. We're just going to do two songs from the opera, one from the beginning, one from the end. The one from the end is particularly over the top and dramatic, so imagine we've spent an hour and a half earning that. The piece is called Pancho from a Safe Distance. It was commissioned by Paul and Martha. Lila Diaz, Luisa Gabino did the libretto. Sean Sides from The Root Max did the directing. Paul Sanchez is our star. For those of you who hosted or saw The Root Max Method Gun, you remember the tiger. So for our show, we have El Tigre. And Margarita has made three little videos featuring El Tigre. So it becomes this through line for with the root next piece. We're going to show you two of those and do the two songs. So it's a little disproportionate because there are only three videos in the whole opera. But, you know, it seemed like it would translate well to the room. The opera itself has two singers, so Paul and Liz, and then a six-piece ensemble. I think that's enough, and so I hope you enjoy the songs. Okay, here's the video.
Pues, me llamo Miguel Santiago Santos. Soy de la comunidad de la Sesión Mendoza, Santiago Timantongo, Oaxaca. Me dicen El Tigre, y tengo 19 años. El 20 de febrero voy a cumplir 20. Y bueno, pues... me hice El Tigre porque, bueno, desde, pues, que andaba en la primaria, me sabía mucho de mi general Francisco Villa, ¿no? Ves que como que te dicen así, muy poca información de la revolución, ¿no? Pero, o sea, ya me trataba en los niños, les sabía más. Y bueno, todos decían, no manches, ¿y cómo sabes? ¿Dónde, no? Y decían, no, pues ese sigue, ¿no? En cuestiones de historia de Francisco Villa y pues sus años, ¿no? Eso, pues fue por eso que el apodo, sí.
Y ahí ya han hecho las voces.
Sí, claro, pues ya he hecho las voces, o sea, fue eso lo que me, no sé, como que me hizo rascar de mano, ¿no?
Entonces empezaron a escuchar, que fue poco después de la primaria, cuando tenía como entre 7 y 8 años, ¿no? Pues cuando los personajes de la televisión, ahí el Benjamín, el Fidelas, digamos, que se disfraza ya de Francisco Villa, que la Felita, así es, ¿no? Pues pues fue un poco después, a lo mejor fue un poco después de que empecé a escuchar las voces, ¿no? Pues hay también familias como que se sacaban la ropa, ¿no? Seamos, pues creo que se juntaban unas tarjetas de, ¿no? Que no escuchaban, ¿no? Y me acuerdo así como que la gente se sorprendía y decía, chamaco, ¿no? ¿Dónde está el perro, no? Últimamente, pues se fue escuchando, bueno, las cosas me han dicho. Pues que tengo una idea de que es a un lugar que se llama San Pablo del Río, Tlalco. Y o sea, yo dije, no manches. Bueno, así como que lo había pedido, ¿no? Pero pues ya me sentí una forma, una vez estoy buscando más o menos el recurso de cómo, pues sí, lo visitaba con la necesidad de dejar de bajar hasta allá. Pero pues no hay como así de, no hay imposibles, ¿no? O sea, cuando quieres. No lo sé qué hay allá, no sé, ¿no? Pero pues, como se queda de que tú, no vas a saber qué es.
Siete leguas el caballo que ya más estimaba, cuando las silbamos de nuevo, se paraba y relinchaba, siete leguas el caballo que ya más estimaba. En la estación de la cuatro cantaban los horizontes, ay, compasión formal, la mirada cabotes, en la estación de la cuatro cantaban los horizontes. Ese es el color, pues que es muy, muy conocido, muy querido de acá, ¿no? De Pancho. Sí.
Muchas gracias.
A ustedes. Muchísimas gracias.
de la experimentar el gran éxito que atravesó todo el país. Pues un viaje bastante largo, otro de todos, y bueno, ya se me acuerdo todos los amores que ella dice, y bueno, pero venimos acá, todas las señales y las, y como lo que me dijeron las voces, es idéntico pues acá donde estamos, igual aparecieron los animales que tenían que aparecer, que las voces me dijeron, y bueno, pues eso me gusta acá.
¿Y qué crees que sea importante que el mundo sepa de Francisco Villa?
Pues más que nada, no sé, los motivos por los cuales estuvo luchando, por qué se aferró tanto a este sueño que tenía, ¿no? Yo creo que eso, también por el mal gobierno, ¿no? Por el mal gobierno que hasta ahorita pues no se ha quitado, ¿no? O sea, sigue, aunque pues fue muy dura la lucha que él tuvo y todo lo demás. O sea, sigue, ¿no? El gobierno, hasta ahorita.
Cuántos jilgueros y sensuntles vio pasar, pero hay que triste cantar esas avecillas. Van a Durango a llorar sobre el parral, donde descansa el general Francisco Villa. Llorar al ver aquella tumba, donde descansa para siempre el general. Sin un clavel o flor ninguna, son hojas secas que le ofrenda al vendaval. De sus dorados nadie quiere recordar que Villa duerme sobre el cielo de Chihuahua. Solo las aves que vuelan sobre el parral van a llorar sobre la tumba abandonada.
La fortuna, duros golpes. Thank you.